Good evening. I'm Gene Merriam, president of the Freshwater Society, and on behalf of the Freshwater Society, I want to welcome you and thank you for coming. This is our sixth lecture over about the last year and a half in the Moos Family Speaker Series, sponsored by the Freshwater Society and the University of Minnesota's College of Biological Sciences. I want to thank our co-sponsors represented here this evening by Dean Bob Eldy of the College of Biological Sciences, who is also a board member of the Freshwater Society. And a special thanks to the Moos family for the Malcolm Moos Freshwater Fund, an endowment that honors Malcolm Moos, president of the University of Minnesota from 1967 to 1974, and a fund which enables this lecture series. We are privileged this evening to have as our guest Dr. Fred Kirschenmann, a distinguished fellow at Iowa State University's Leopold Center for Sustainable Agriculture. He's the author of a 2002 collection of essays, Cultivating an Ecological Conscience, Essays from a Farmer Philosopher. Tonight's lecture is Water and the Challenges Facing the U.S. and World Agriculture in the 21st Century. After Dr. Kirschenmann's talk, a panel of three Minnesota experts from different perspectives in the field of agricultural sustainability will offer a brief reaction and their comments on the presentation. Then they will join Dr. Kirschenmann in taking your questions. By way of housekeeping, Dr. Eldy will moderate the panel discussion. We're passing out file cards for your written questions, and we will have roving microphones available as well. This session is being videotaped, and if you have friends and acquaintances who could not be here this evening, please let them know they can watch the video. There's a link to it on our website. A little bit about our guest that we're privileged to have here this evening. Dr. Kirschenmann grew up on a farm near Jamestown, North Dakota. His father and mother started farming in the Dust Bowl years of the 1930s. The loss of soil in those years inflicted on the Great Plains made his father a radical conservationist, a description that is apt for Dr. Kirschenmann as well. He earned a bachelor's degree in religion at Yankton College, then a master's and a doctorate degree in historical theology from the University of Chicago. In the 1970s, he was academic dean of Curry College. When he left academia to return to the family farm and turn it into a certified organic beef and grain operation. He still owns that farm with his sister, and he is actively engaged in managing it. In his operation of that farm, in his work with other organic farmers, and in his work since 2000 at the Leopold Center for Sustainable Agriculture, Dr. Kirschenmann has become a national leader in organic and sustainable farming. This year, the James Beard Foundation honored him for lifelong work on sustainable food and farming systems. Please join me in welcoming our speaker this evening, Dr. Kirschenmann.
Well, thank you very much. It's a distinct pleasure to join you here this evening. And I was telling some people earlier that I was wishing it wasn't such a large crowd because I really prefer dialogue to monologue. And there's always a conflict, you know, when you do this sort of thing because the kind of topic that we're dealing with tonight, I could go on for 2 or 3 hours. And so you try to do that in, we're going to try to do this in 50 minutes or so. And then, you know, as you indicated, some time for the panel, and I would really want to get to, you know, your questions and your concerns. And the other thing I want to let you know is that something that which was not in my bio is that I come from a tradition of Russian Germans, and we have not had a good day unless we had at least one argument. And I haven't had mine yet today, so I'm hoping that if any of us say something that you disagree with, that you will feel very free to share that with us so that we can have an engaging time. I also, as was indicated, I'm a philosopher by academic training and a farmer by experience-based learning. And so the perspective that I'm going to bring to some of the issues that I think we have to deal with in our food and farming system as we move into the future is going to come from that dual perspective. And I hope that that will provide us with some interesting insights that I think we don't often hear in the public media and probably not even from our academic world or our industrial world for us to think about tonight. And so I just want to share that with you as kind of a framework. And I want to also let you know that given that background of mine, one of the things that I think serves as a problem, especially when we deal with things like water and the quality of water and the future of water on this planet, is that we have developed a culture, and this is the philosophy side of me, we have developed a culture of science which really interprets the world in terms of everything in a kind of linear cause-effect relationship, so that if something happens on your farm or something happens in your family or something happens in your business, there's got to be a single cause that caused that, right? And then we try to figure out how we can shift that cause in order to get a different kind of effect for what we want. And I think that's one of the key problems that we have to face as we think about how we're going to manage our activities on this planet in order to have the kind of water quality and the kind of water resources that we're going to need in order to sustain a reasonable kind of life on this planet. And so I think what we have to do is begin to adopt more of what's more of a modern, if I can use that word, kind of view of science now, which is more rooted in the notion that the kind of world that we live in isn't this, you know, these neat kinds of pieces that are in this linear cause-effect relationship, but rather it's a very dynamic world with all kinds of dynamic aspects to it that are very interrelated and interdependent and affect each other in ways that we sometimes don't even begin to understand. And so it's a very complex issue. And the reason I think it's so important as we deal with issues of water is that I think part of the problem that we've had in recent decades is we have tried to deal with water as an isolated issue. And if we can just get people to manage their farms differently, manage their activities differently, then we can solve the problem. And that's only part of the equation, I think. And so what I want to share with you tonight is within that context. So I just wanted to share that by way of introduction. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time tonight to talk about the details of the kind of problems that we have with water on our planet, because I'm assuming that most of you wouldn't be here if you weren't already aware of at least some of those things. And if you, in fact, want to get more detail about that, and I'm indebted to Pat for calling this to my attention, there's a new series report which just came out last month entitled A Framework for the 21st Century Water Risk Management. And if you want to get a comprehensive view about some of these, the more details of the kinds of issues and problems that we're dealing with, it's about as good a recent piece that I've read. And so if you're not acquainted with some of the details of the problems we're dealing with. But I don't want to deal so much with the problems. I want to deal with how we think about the future of water and and how we can begin to address some of these issues from, I think, a slightly different perspective than what most of us have heard, at least if what we're depending on is the popular media for our perspective. So suffice it to say that there are two key issues that we all need to address in relationship to water as we think about our future. And one of those is the issue of water quality. And again, as I'm not going to go into detail here, but you know, if you're paying any attention in the media at all, you know that we've got a serious problem with hypoxia zones, or popularly referred to as dead zones. And the scientists who are working with this have identified, I think the latest figure I've seen, a little over 400 dead zones on the planet. But they're anticipating by the time they get all of them identified, it's going to be like more than 1,000. And these are results of the way in which we manage our activities on this planet, whether you're a farmer or a miner or anybody else. These dead zones are caused by the kind of wastes that we create from our human activities, which then essentially kill the life within our oceans, within our waters. We also know that we have increasingly difficult problems in terms of maintaining the kind of quality of our drinking water. And again, that's due primarily to the kind of activities that we have that cause contamination in our drinking water. And then there's also another key issue, a central issue, is the deterioration of our ocean ecologies, which are now increasingly threatening the sea life. So in addition to overfishing, we now are affecting the healthy ecology, which enables, you know, our sea life to regenerate itself. And that's a huge problem for a lot of reasons, but not least of which is that, you know, there are significant populations of our human species that are dependent on seafood for their primary protein. So in terms of water quality, as a kind of, you know, a quick sort of wraparound way of thinking about that. So that's one of the problems. The other problem that we're facing with regard to water is the rate at which we're depleting our fresh water on the planet. And this is not as well known because it's not been in the media as much as the water quality issues. But increasingly now, it's going to be coming into the popular media because we're simply running out of fresh water in a lot of places at the same time that we're beginning to see more periods of extensive drought. And so that's going to create a serious problem. And part of the reason that we're depleting our water so rapidly is because of the way that we're managing our soil, which no longer absorbs and retains water the way it once did when it was, you know, the kind of healthy soil that we had when we had more perennials on the landscape. And so we now are using 70% of all of our freshwater resources on this planet just for agricultural irrigation. And so that's a major drain. And then, of course, as I say, we got these more extreme droughts. We, of course, have an increasing human population, which requires more water. And with this increasing human population, we have more increased crop acres. And so that also requires more irrigation. So these are all issues that are going on right now, which are depleting our freshwater resources. And we now have the Ogallala Aquifer, just as a few examples, the Ogallala Aquifer, which is the primary source of irrigation water in the heartland, we have now drawn down essentially by half since 1960. And this is a fossil aquifer, so it can't be recharged rapidly. And so already there are farmers on the edge of the aquifer who've had to give up irrigating their crops because they can no longer get down to the water. And this is going on all across the planet. We're drawing down where many of our rivers now no longer reach the end of their trajectory because we use up the water before it gets there. Some of our lakes are being drained. So as our human population increases and as our soil becomes more depleted, doesn't have the capacity to absorb and retain moisture, and we need more irrigation, you know, this is a future that a future issue, a future problem that's going to be a serious issue that we all have to attend to. Now, some of the research that we've been doing which has in fact tried to address some of the alternative approaches that we should be thinking about. And this is by far, and I'll talk about this more a little bit later, this is by far not the major part of our research. And I'm not just talking about land-grant universities here, I'm talking about generally, you know, the public research investment that we make primarily does not deal with alternative approaches that begin to really address these problems. Most of our research is done to try to make the current system work a little bit better. But we do have, fortunately, some individuals, and they're kind of dispersed all around the country, who recognize these issues and who are really beginning to address some of these issues from a different perspective. There are some scientists now, for example, that are looking at this whole issue of soil health and the difference that healthy soil can make in terms of this rate at which we're depleting our water resources. And what they've discovered is that if you have 1% organic matter in your soil, and organic matter is only one measure of a healthy soil, but an important one. If you have 1% organic matter in your soil, the soil has the capacity to absorb and retain about 33 pounds of water per cubic yard. If you have 5% organic matter, it's 195 pounds. So if you think about that for a minute, if we could begin, and I'm not saying that you can get 5% organic matter everywhere because it depends on, you know, the kind of soil that you start with, but there are a lot of places, certainly places like Iowa and many places in Minnesota, you could get soil not only to 5%, but 6%, 7%. You have some farmers that are already doing this by the way they're managing their soil. So if we could begin to increase the organic matter of our soil to its complete, its full capacity, we could reduce the amount of irrigation water we need by a factor of 5 or 6. So think about that. That would mean in terms of the smaller amounts of water that we would need in order to maintain the kind of productive capacity that we have. Another example is the effect which diversity can have in terms of our quality of our water. And a good friend of mine who's a weed ecologist at Iowa State University, his name is Matt Liebman, and some of you may know him. If you want to look at some of the work that he's done in the research, you can go on our website at the Leopold Center, and we've featured a lot of it there. But Matt's done a interesting research project for the last 8 years at our Iowa State University Marsden farm, and he has a cropping system. What Matt has done is taken an area on the research farm of about 8 acres, and he's divided it into two different plots. And the one plot is a 4-acre plot where he has a two-crop rotation, typical corn-soybean rotation, which, you know, is now 92% of Iowa's cropland, isn't just those two crops. And then on the other plot, the other 4 acres, he's divided into two plots. And one is a 3-crop rotation, corn, soybeans, and then oats with red clover. And the other is a 4-crop or a 4-year rotation, corn, soybeans, and then oats and alfalfa, and then another year of alfalfa, and then back to corn and soybeans again. And everything else is exactly the same. The variety of seed is the same. The date that he plants it is the same. The date he harvests it the same. Everything else is the same except the rotation. That rotation is different. And here's what Matt's discovered. The 4-year rotation uses 75% less nitrogen to maintain its productivity. Now, think about nitrates being one of the key contributors to the dead zones, et cetera, and to the kind of nitrate contamination that we have in our rivers and our streams in the heartland here. 75% less nitrogen, 90% less pesticides. So to the extent that toxic pesticides are part of the problem, this could be a major, major reduction. And here's the interesting thing, the return to land and labor on that 4-crop rotation is actually slightly higher than the 2-year rotation. Now, you know, when we saw this research, you know, and I did this myself, you know, you go to some farmers and I just say, you know, why don't you do this? Oh my goodness, you can, you know, you save all of this money, you provide all of this environmental benefit to the health of the ecology and to the quality of the water, and you actually get a better return than you do with the 2-crop rotation. Why wouldn't you do this? What do you think the farmers will say? Okay, what the hell am I going to do with the alfalfa? I can't take it to a local elevator and sell it. And that's, of course, the difference between a research project and the real world. In a research project, you know, when you've got 4 acres of alfalfa, you can find a good market for it and you get that return. But if every farmer did that in Iowa, you know, what would you do with all that alfalfa? Because you can't, and now, given the point here is the kind of market infrastructure that we've created that farmers have to operate in, and we, you know, farmers don't feed alfalfa anymore because we've also concentrated our animals. And so the animals have to be fed corn because that's concentrated protein. You can't afford to transport the alfalfa that distance to feed it. So there isn't a market for the alfalfa. So if farmers actually wanted to adopt what Matt Lieben has learned and all those benefits, it wouldn't work for them in the current market structure. So that's the bind that you know, that farmers often find themselves in. Another kind of research which is also interesting is the development of cover crops and perennial crops. And the cover crop issue has been very interesting because, you know, again, there are all kinds of benefits with a cover. Cover crop is basically like you have a corn-soybean rotation, and then after you harvest your soybeans, you go and plant a cover crop in there. And then farmers like to apply their nitrogen in the fall because that's a window that they have. So you apply your nitrogen, you plant your cover crop, and then the cover crop will absorb that nitrogen into the crop and hold the nitrogen over the winter months. And then in the spring, you incorporate that cover crop back into the soil, and it releases the nitrogen. And you then save, instead of losing that nitrogen going down the Mississippi River into the Gulf of Mexico, you hold it there, and then you don't have to apply as much nitrogen. Now, again, when we first started to talk to farmers about that, well, yeah, it's kind of interesting, but, you know, I don't have time to do that because, you know, I've got 5,000 acres I've got to cover, and, you know, by the time I get done harvesting the corn and the beans, all I've done, maybe got time to apply the nitrogen, but I don't have time, you know, to plant a cover crop and do all of that, and it's another activity that I got to do. It's another, you know, it complicates the system. Now, what we're starting to find as nitrogen costs are going up, as we're seeing, you know, fertilizer costs go up and other costs go up, more farmers are, in fact, now beginning to adopt that. And that's an interesting thing, and I want you to kind of keep that in mind because we're going to talk about some of the economic drivers here as we move into the future. So I think that we're going to see more farmers deciding to use cover crops because they're going to see the benefit from that. And they can still do the, you know, the corn-soybean rotation, which the market supports for them. Perennials is another issue that's very, very interesting. And we do know that the use of perennials in terms of incorporating, and again, some research that we've done at Iowa State University indicates that if we just put 10% of our Iowa cropland into perennials, and it would have to be, of course, very targeted areas, the areas where you have the most erosion, et cetera, just 10% into perennials, we could reduce our soil erosion by over 50%. And so again, you know, you say, well, why wouldn't you want to do that? Well, you know, where are the public policies that really give farmers the incentive to do that and give them the kind of return instead of having that in terms of their short-term return in corn and beans? And so, again, we've got to look at some of these things. But the other thing about perennials that, as we think about the future, that's even much more significant is the kind of research that's been done at the Land Institute now for the last 30 years. And Wes Jassen, who is, you know, one of these people that everybody kind of used to think was crazy, had decided at some point that it was possible to perennialize our annual crops so you could actually have perennials on the landscape to produce your annual grain, what we currently do with annual grains. And that would have enormous benefits because, first of all, perennials would sequester much more carbon in the soil because you've got green crops growing, you know, for 6, 7, 8 months out of the year instead of 3 months. It dramatically improve your soil quality because you've got this root system that enriches the soil, that maintains its vitality, et cetera. Farmers don't have to plant every year. They plant probably once every 6 or 7 years. So you save an enormous amount of energy. So there are enormous benefits from this. Now, that's a long-term project, but the progress which has been made now, and it's not no longer being done just at The Land Institute, in fact, some perennials are being researched here at University of Minnesota, some in other Washington State University and other places, some perennial rice is being worked on in China. So if we were, and Wes Jackson and Wendell Berry and I went to Washington, D.C. a little over a year ago and tried to encourage USDA to get involved in this, and Wes made a proposal to them and offered USDA to give all of the genetics that the Land Institute has developed over the last 30 years for free, provided that USDA would commit $50 million a year for the next 50 years to really get this research done and get these perennial crops available. And our estimation is that if that were to be done, that 50 years from now, we could have over 60% of our annual crops in perennials by that time. That would be an enormous shift, an enormous benefit. I don't even have to go into details, so you can imagine the impact that, that would have, you know, on the quality of our water and also on the amount of water that we would need for producing our food. So these are just some of the things that are, you know, possibilities now that are not yet being fully addressed in the way that they could be in terms of the kinds of changes that we could see. So let's talk for a little bit about the public outreach with regard to with all of the with the problems that we have around water. And here again, I want to make clear from the beginning that I'm not going to say what I'm saying now as any kind of criticism, but rather as an observation of how we've been trying to deal with our public outreach. And there's primarily been two efforts that we have made in terms of trying to deal with these issues and the kind of water quality problems and now increasingly water depletion problems. And what we have tried to do is we have created an environmental movement to address that. And that was done to increase, primarily to increase public awareness and to get the public behind some protection of these resources that we need to protect. And the result of all that was some additional and improved regulations. And you all know this. So we have a Clean Water Act now. We have a Clean Air Act. We have an Environmental Protection Agency. And if it were not for the fact that we have been successful in the environmental movement to create these public responses, we all know that things would be a whole lot worse now than they are. We have not solved the problem, that's clear, but we have made some significant improvements, and we should celebrate that. But the question we need to ask ourselves is whether or not an environmental movement in the mode that it has been in the past is still going to enable us to eventually get to the point where we solve the problems in the future, and that's the way that's where we want to get to before the end of the evening. The second public outreach movement was the conservation community and the conservation movement, and the primary thing on the part of the conservation movement was to expand and preserve wild nature. And the idea behind that was that if we protect and expand and improve the amount of acres in wild nature, then wild nature will preserve our biodiversity. It will provide all of these other ecosystem services that we need to address the problems, not just of water quality, but that being a part of it. The problem is that we have, in fact, I mean, the good news is that we have increased our acreage. And I haven't had a chance to look at exactly where we are now, but as we, the various wild areas in this country that we have preserved that are, you know, either parks or other kinds of public domain places. We have not achieved the kinds of results that we wanted from, or that we thought we would get from that effort. Part of those results that we thought we would have is that we would preserve the biodiversity of our species, that we would get all of those benefits that we know are a part of wild nature. That didn't happen. I mean, it happened to some extent, but not nearly what we anticipated. And I think the thing that we forgot in doing that is something that Aldo Leopold had observed already back in the 1930s when he made this famous observation, and when she said that the boundary between tame and wild exists only in the imperfections of the human mind. In other words, in the real world, you can't separate the wild from the tame. They're all a part of the same ecology. Again, it's part of that complex interrelated system that all works together. And so trying to isolate a part of nature and maintaining the diversity and the health of the wild nature, and assuming then that the tame part of it, we can do whatever we want with it and still maintain that health of that system and diversity of that system, hasn't worked and won't work. So one of the things, again, that I think is very interesting right now is that our conservationists, of course, now have recognized this. So, you know, in the past, the conservationists sort of seen themselves as wearing the white hats and the farmers wearing the black hats. The farmers saw themselves wearing the white hats and the conservationists wearing the black hats because they were kind of interfering with their farming activities. I think we're at a point now where the conservationists recognize they're going to need the work with the tame part and have the farmers be a part of our efforts. And the farmers are at least beginning to realize that they need at least a part of wild nature for their farms to be productive. And if nothing else, we're now seeing that in bees and bats, which we're losing at an enormous rate. And most farmers, at least that I've talked to, are very aware of how the loss of bats and bees are going to affect the productivity of their farms. So I think we have an opportunity to get rid of that boundary between tame and wild in the imperfections of our minds and begin to have a new kind of conversation in which we address this from a different perspective. So the real question then as we look at all of this is, what are the barriers to our success? And we've made these heroic efforts to try to solve these problems and try to get us moving in the right kind of direction. What are the barriers to our success? And it seems to me that one of the major barriers to our success is that all of our human enterprises are operated now on the basis of an industrial economy. And the industrial economy involved really with the beginning of the Industrial Revolution, so it's been in play for the last three or four centuries in this country. And an industrial economy operates on a very simple set of goals, and that is maximum efficient production for short-term economic return. And it doesn't make any difference whether you're manufacturing automobiles or computers or producing food. That's what you have to do. And if you're not operating on the basis of maximum efficient production for short-term economic return, the understanding is that you're simply not going to be in business very long, because those are the rules that everybody plays by. Okay? Now, the means by which you do that, the means by which you achieve that goal of maximum efficient production for short-term economic return is what? Specialization, simplification of management, and economies of scale. And if you want a good example of that, you know, when Henry Ford developed the first automobile manufacturing system, those were exactly the principles that he used. He once famously said that people could buy any car they wanted as long as it was a black Ford Model T, because that was all he was going to manufacture, because that was that specialization which was necessary in order to achieve that maximum efficient production for short-term economic return. And then simplification of management. You know, Ford didn't train everybody on his assembly line to produce a whole automobile. That would have been too complex. It was not simplified management. What he did was trained each person on that assembly line to do one simple thing. And then at the end of the assembly line, you had the automobile, right? That's what made it efficient, maximum efficient production. And then, of course, economies of scale. You had to produce enough automobiles in order to get the kind of production capacity that enabled you to maximize your economic return. And Henry Ford, however, also had one other principle that he understood was necessary, and that is to pay his workers enough so they could afford to buy the cars. That's one principle we sort of lost in our economy, and maybe we should think about that again. And then the practice that we use, and here I'm going to talk primarily about agriculture and the food system, the practice that we use in this industrial economy are single tactic therapeutic intervention, because again, that's the way you get that maximum efficient production for short-term economic return. So if a farmer finds that the soil is being depleted of its nutrient value, what does he do? He brings in single tactic therapeutic intervention. He brings in a synthetic fertilizer in order to provide that fertility that has been lost in the soil because the soil has not been managed to maintain that fertility, right? It's, again, it's the simple way to do that. If he finds that he has a pest problem, what does he do? Again, sickle tactic, therapeutic invention. He comes in with a pesticide to get rid of the pest. Now, that, again, has been very effective for farmers on the short term. On the long term, as we're beginning to learn now, it is absolutely not sustainable. And Joe Lewis, who is a pest management specialist with the Agriculture Research Service, he and his colleagues, in fact, wrote an article. And if you haven't seen this, I would encourage you to get on Google and Google Joe Lewis, and you'll find the article is still available. He wrote an article that was published, he and his colleagues wrote an article that was published in the National Academy of Sciences Proceedings in 1997 called Natural Systems Management. And what he pointed out, now based on 50 years of experience as a pest management specialist, that this single tactic therapeutic intervention, you know, you got a pest problem, you come in with a pesticide to get rid of it, never solved the problem. In fact, it created the problem, part of the problem you're trying to solve. Because in the first place, you never get rid of all of the target pests. So you create some resistant pests, which increases your problem. And in the process of trying to get rid of that target pest, you also destroy a lot of the other biological richness of that community, which previously kept some pests in check. So you have a pest resurgence. So that was his observation. Now, in the July 1st issue of 2010 of Nature magazine, there are now reports of peer-reviewed research that actually verifies through peer-reviewed research that Joe Lewis was exactly correct about that. And they use an interesting term called biological evenness. So in this peer-reviewed research, what they did was they took one approach, which was the conventional approach, single tactic therapeutic intervention to get rid of the pest. And sure enough, in that, you reduced your pest problems on the short term, but then reemergence came back very quickly. Whereas in the other system, which in this case was organic, but I want to make clear that simply because it's organic doesn't mean that it has that natural systems management, but they managed it in terms of maintaining the biological richness, and it was that biological richness which, sure, they had some pest problems, but it never emerged to a point where it was a serious problem. And so in looking at these two systems, what they said was that in that single tactic therapeutic intervention approach, what they did is destroyed the biological evenness, which kept the pests in check over here, and then that's what caused the resurgence over here. So now we know that this is how the systems work. But this, again, is relatively new research that's not very well known and certainly not been demonstrated to a large number of farmers. I think that as we begin to develop this, and here's a very interesting project for cooperative extension to take this kind of information and work with farmers in terms of changing to that kind of an approach. And then finally, the fourth thing that I think is important about this industrial economy approach is that it develops a kind of ethic for farmers. And I think that Paul Thompson, who's at Michigan State University, articulated this most clearly and beautifully in one of his books, which he published several years ago. And he said, what this system does now is it forces farmers into an ethical framework in which they operate now, have to operate out of a single ethic, and that is to produce as much as possible regardless of the cost. And he wasn't just saying environmental costs, even economic costs. And again, there was some interesting research that was done by a group of extension specialists at North Dakota State University about 20 years ago, in which some extension specialists realized that this producing as much as possible regardless of the cost was actually costing farmers in terms of their net income. And so what they did was did some research to find out what the maximum economic yield for the farmers could be. And they called it the MEY Club. And they had a number of farmers that actually joined that club. And what they found consistently was that farmers used that extra input, which cost them money, to produce that extra 10% of yield. Actually, they lost money as a result of doing that. And so what they did was try to find where was that maximum economic yield so that they could address this producing as much as possible regardless of the cost. And that actually worked pretty well for a while. And then gradually it just faded away because, again, farmers were caught inside that ethic of producing as much as possible, because if they weren't doing that, somehow they weren't really serious farmers. So we have some cultural issues there that we have to address. Okay, so one of the other barriers that we're facing as a result of this industrial economy is now our aging and depleting farm population. And this is something that's, again, not very well known in our culture, because of the way in which we have communicated our agricultural statistics to the general public. As most of you know, we have an ag census that we do every 5 years, a national ag census. And we get the numbers of farmers that we have, et cetera. And when the 2007 census data came out, it was really interesting because there was a lot of euphoria in the public about the fact that we now have 2.2 million farmers instead of 2.1 million, which is where we were in the 2002 census data. And there was all this euphoria, and journalists all over the United States were, you know, championing this. In fact, this is such great news because we now have 2.2 million farmers. Even Verlin Klinkenborg, who originally is from Iowa, did a great article in the New York Times about how the farmers in Iowa had actually increased. There was only one journalist that I know of that actually understood the real situation. And the reason she did is because she talked to Mike Duffy at Iowa State University, who's a friend of mine. And Mike has been following these ag census data for the last 30 years. And Mike has been complaining for a long time that we're not telling the true story because we're still using a 1974 definition of a farm. And that is any place that produces $1,000 in gross sales or would have produced $1,000 in gross sales had that place maximized its full production capacity, and then you're a farm. So Lisa Hamilton, who is a freelance journalist, she had talked with Mike, and so she did an op-ed for the Prairie Writer Circle, which was still being published back then. And so she starts out her article by saying, well, so 2.2 million farmers, and that sounds really great, but nobody's asking what a farm is. And then she quotes the definition, which Mike had shared with her. And then she said, so I live in a suburban home and I have 4 chickens in my backyard. And if I really maximize the full production capacity of those 4 chickens, I could sell $500 worth of eggs. So all I need is 4 more chickens and I'm a farm. And then, you know, and one of the things I want to make clear here, I'm not trying to say that farmers who, or people who produce $500 worth of good food and sell it at a farmer's market, I want to call them farmers. But what we have to do is communicate to the public what our actual farm numbers are in terms of our food security for the future. And when Mike breaks this down and peels it apart, here's where we are. What Mike points out is that 75% of our total gross agricultural sales in this country, in other words, our total agricultural production, is now being produced by just 192,442 farms. And 30% of our farmers are over age 65, and only 6% are under age 35. Now, you can't push those statistics very far into the future before we have a very serious human capital problem on our hands, not only in terms of dealing with some of the complexities and some of the new information and the new transitions that we need to make to deal with our problems of water quality and water availability, but also simply to have the human capacity to produce the food that we need to produce. So we have to get clear. We have to find a way to communicate to the general public that when we say we have 2.2 million farmers, that's not the production capacity of our farmers. 75% from 192,442 farms. And 30% of our farmers over age 65 means that population is going to go down pretty rapidly. So where are the future farmers going to come from? That's a question that we have to face. The other thing that's a part of the problem is the decline in the share of economic activity of the farm sector of our food system. And Stu Smith did a study for the United States Congress back in 1997 on this. And what he pointed out, he looked at what the share of economic, and the share of economic activity is what part of producing food falls into the different sectors. So there's the market sector and the farm sector and the input sector. And what he pointed out was that from 1910 to 1997, The market sector increased its share by over 30%. The input sector increased its share by almost 20%. And during that same time, the farm sector share of economic activity had decreased by that same amount. And what he pointed out was that if those trends continue into the future, then by the year 2020, the farm sector would disappear from our food system. Well, a lot of people said, well, come on, you know, we're always going to have some farmers. But, you know, it was actually 1 year after that when Stephen Blank, who was a professor of agriculture and resource economics at UC Davis, published a book entitled The End of Agriculture in the American Portfolio. And his whole thesis was, look, farmers aren't making any money because they're doing the raw material supplies and there's not enough money. You know, people are making money in the value part of the economy. So we just ought to get out of the agriculture business altogether and simply get our raw materials from other countries where they have much cheaper labor and cheaper raw materials. And we just get out of the agriculture business. Well, you know, that's sort of an extreme position, and I don't think anybody really took that seriously. But nevertheless, that gives an idea of where our thinking goes. Now, there was also an article in Time magazine in 1992, which was looking at the poultry industry at that point and looking at the role which farmers played in producing our poultry meat for us. And they referred to farmers in that system as serfs on their own land. So again, when you look at what Stu Smith was talking about, you have in fact eliminated the farm sector of our food business. Now again, the reason that this is so important, because my position is, as you look at the kind of challenges we're going to be facing in the future, and I'll get to those in a minute, we're going to need some of the smartest, most dedicated, and engaged farmers that we've ever had in the history of agriculture. Because this is the kind of agriculture which we're going to have to not only deal with our problems of water quality and water availability, but also with the kind of food system that we need, we're going to need a human capital of the kind that we've never seen before. Now, the other issue, of course, is in all of this, or in terms of our industrial economy, is where our farm policy is with regard to this. And of course, any of you who have followed our farm policy issues know that there's not been a lot of changes. You know, it's very hard to get any significant changes in farm policy at USDA or in the United States Congress. And the reason for that is because our current farm policy is dictated almost entirely by the vested interests in the current system. And those vested interests are enormously powerful. It's not just the farmers. They don't have that much power. But the farmers who are fairly well organized in terms of commodity agriculture, but very much in link with the input suppliers and the processing companies, which do have enormous amount of political clout. And they're all, and again, not being critical here, understandably, they have all made huge investments in the current system. And so naturally, they are going to do everything they can to keep the current system in place and to have the kind of public policies that will maintain the current system. And so at this point, it's very difficult to get the kind of policy changes that we need in order to move into the future. Now, that's all of the bad news. And the thing that we have to also realize is, despite all of this, despite all of these barriers, et cetera, that we're dealing with, the system has still been fairly successful in terms of maximum efficient production and short-term economic return. So the food industry has still done fairly well. As a matter of fact, Bill Heffernan, who's a friend of mine, he's retired now, but was a rural sociologist at the University of Missouri, and he told me once, and this was like 5 or 6 years ago, and I don't know if this is still true, I haven't checked with him, but I can't imagine that it's changed much. He told me once, he said that the return on investment in food is second only to the return on investment in pharmaceuticals. In other words, in terms of that short-term economic return for investors in the food system, it's enormously successful. And so naturally, again, investors in that system are going to do everything they can to try to keep the current system going. Now, the thing, however, that we have to realize now, and this is where we're going to reach this juncture in our world, where we're going to move into a very different kind of future. And I can't tell you whether that future is going to come on in the next 5 years or the next 10 years or the next 20 years, but it'll certainly be within that two-decade time frame. And that is that the reason that the system is still successful is because it is based absolutely on cheap energy, fossil fuels, on cheap minerals, things like rock phosphate and potassium, etc. We've had those in abundant supply. Cheap metals, iron ore, etc., all of the things which go in to make all of the farm equipment which makes this system work. The fresh water, which we've had in abundant amounts. And land, which we've always had land available. You know, we could always move to the next, you know, we ran out of land in the Midwest, well, we could move further west. Or, you know, and now, even now, you know, we're still, you know, this is going to be one of those issues. All of these issues that I'm mentioning here, energy, minerals, metals, land, water, all of these now are in a state of decline. And so the reason that we're starting to see this movement of land grabs, you know, of people, farmers from Iowa going to Brazil and getting hold of land to raise soybeans, farmers going to Tanzania to rent land for 25 cents an acre in order to take Iowa's agriculture. And I'm not singling out Iowa here. I mean, this is a global issue, global effort that's going on. So these are the, you know, the abundant natural resources that we have had that has made this industrial food system so successful, and they are now in a state of decline, and over a period of time the system simply will no longer work. The other piece that's changed is that we have had over this period of time, over the last, and also it's important to remember here that we applied the industrial system of economy to agriculture essentially after the Second World War. You know, farmers have been resistant to this for a long time. It was basically after the Second World War when we brought some of the technology from the war back and applied them to agriculture that we began to apply it on a large scale. The other thing that we had during this period of time was we had sufficient sinks in nature to absorb the waste. So, you know, the dead zones didn't appear until, what, about 15 or 20 years ago. And it took us for a while to really be realizing that it was happening because nature was capable of absorbing that. The sinks are now full, and so we can't do that anymore. And then, of course, the other resource that we've had. So we've had these natural resources, we've had the natural sinks, and we've also had relatively stable climates. And if you're going to have that system of specialization, simplification of management, and economies of scale, you have to have stable climates. Right now, 92% of our cultivated land in Iowa is in just two crops, corn and soybeans. That means you have to have climate that's consistently favorable to corn and soybeans if you're going to maintain productivity. And as I think we all understand now, seeing the kind of changes that the climate instability that we're starting to see, that's not going to be our future. So the question then becomes, what kind of food system are we going to create that's going to be able to produce our food under these new circumstances? Well, right now there are there's a debate going on. There's two different approaches, two different answers to that question of how we're going to do this. The one answer to the question is that what we need to do in order to be able to produce the kind of food that we need under these two circumstances is to further intensify what we've already been doing, further intensify the industrial system. So we develop more new technologies, we push the pedal to the metal a little harder, and we're going to be able to do it. And it's usually presented as this is the only answer. There's no other way to feed, quote, 9 billion people, which we're going to have at 2050, which is, you know, again, the way the issue is framed. And there are a lot of individuals behind this particular position who have a great deal of confidence in the technologies that we have not even dreamt of developing yet, which we're going to develop, which is going to solve the problem. It's what Wes Jackson refers to as technological fundamentalism. I think the most extreme example of that that any of us have discovered is a statement by Julian Simon, who wrote an article for the 1995 Cato Policy Report, which he entitled The State of Humanity, steadily improving. And here's the statement which he made in that policy report. Technology exists now to produce in virtually inexhaustible quantities just about all the products made by nature. We have it in our hands now, actually in our libraries, the technology to feed, clothe, and supply energy to an ever-growing population for the next 7 billion years. Now, like I say, I mean, I know there's a few people who took that statement seriously. Most everybody said, you know, this is a little crazy. But nevertheless, this reflects a culture of technology that a lot of people share. You know, they would argue with the 7 billion years business part of it, but that this is the way to go, that this is how we solve the problem. This is what we have to do. And then, of course, with that is the notion that we have the capacity for unlimited growth. And so all we got to do is come up with the technologies to keep working at this, and then we can continue to grow, and everything will be fine. And, you know, this is part of the, in my view, part of the real problem that we have in our current political debate. Because whether you're a conservative or a liberal, both sides of that equation are really operating on the notion that we can get our economy back on track, which means back to the kind of growth that it had in the past. Now, again, if you think about these limited resources that I just described to you, how are you going to maintain unlimited material growth when you have these resources in a state of depletion? How are you going to do that when crude oil gets to $300 a barrel, which it will at some point? So these are the issues that we have to address. Now, the second approach to this is that, no, we can't solve this problem simply by intensifying what we've done in the past. What we have to do is redesign it. What we have to do now is no longer operate under the goal of maximum efficient production for short-term economic return. We have to redesign it to a goal for resilient production on a long-term basis with appropriate scale in order for the system to become sustainable in the long term. That's an entirely different design. If we were to design it for resilience rather than short-term maximum efficient production on a short-term basis, then we would come up with an entirely different kind of system. And most of my colleagues who are beginning to look at the future from that perspective are saying that what we need to do is abandon the industrial model and adopt an agroecological model. Because in an agroecological model, what you do is you fundamentally change your relationship to nature. Instead of treating nature, as Wes Jackson likes to say, nature either gets subdued or ignored, that's what we've done through our whole industrial period. What we need to do now is revere nature and make nature a part of how we do things. How does nature maintain its resilience? And then how can we create agriculture and food systems that mimic nature and achieve that? So that's the kind of shift in our thinking. And there, again, part of the good news here is there are individual farmers all around the world who have begun to move in that direction, who adopted actually some very practical production systems. We have some in Iowa. You have some here in Minnesota. We have other parts of the world. And basically, the examples which I think are the most promising are, again, perennialization, which has enormous potential for resilient, long-term production rather than maximum efficient short-term production and on an appropriate scale. And permaculture, which are mostly small-scale farms, but there's some fascinating examples of farmers, you know, who do not have large amounts of energy input and single-tacted therapeutic intervention from outside. They've developed the kind of biological synergies where part of the system solves and feeds a part of another part of the system. And you have these very dynamic things. And, you know, I don't have time to go into a lot of it. Let me give you a very short version of one of my favorite examples is a farmer in southern Japan. His name is Takao Furuno. And if you're interested, he's published a book called The Power of Duck. And up until 1987, he was a typical industrial farmer. That is, he was monoculture rice, maximum efficient production for short-term economic return, specialization, simplification, economies of scale. So monoculture rice brought in all the fertilizer he needed to maintain the productivity, get maximum production, all of the pesticides he needed to control his pest problems and his weed problems, etc. And then as he told me his story, he said 1987, one day he literally stood back from his rice paddies And he realized that every year that everything he earned on his farm, he had to reinvest in the next year's crop, and he didn't get to keep anything. He didn't want to do that anymore. And somehow he knew that simply tweaking the system, making it a little bit more efficient, not using quite as much fertilizer, et cetera, wasn't going to solve the problem. He had to redesign the system. So he came up with a very interesting idea. He thought, what would happen if I took the best wisdom from the past and married that with the best science available today? Could I come up with an entirely different system? Well, to make a long story short, he discovered wisdom from the past that farmers in Japan in the past used to raise ducks in their rice paddies. Why were they doing that? So he started to get, he got himself some little ducklings and put them in some, got a plastic piece of plastic electric fence and put it down in the middle of his rice paddy, put the ducklings back in there, and then sat back and watched and discovered these little ducklings were eating insects off of the rice plant. And he thought, ah, if I had enough of the right kind of ducks, would they take care of the insects? I wouldn't need to buy a pesticide anymore. That's money I could keep in my pocket. So he went to the scientists and talked to them and said, you know, what about this? And he said, well, yeah, you know, we've actually done some research and we think there is a duck. It's called an agamo, which is a cross between a wild drake and a domesticated female, and it seems to us that they would be the most aggressive insect grazers. So he started to breed these ducks and put them into his rice paddies and discovered 200 ducks per hectare. They eat all the insects. So now he doesn't need to buy pesticides anymore. And then he's thinking, you know, farmers used to also have fish in their rice paddies, and then when the Green Revolution came along and they were encouraged to grow as much, again, maximum production, grow as much rice as possible, and the way to do that was to use pesticides to get rid of the pests, which of course killed the fish. So then they had to give up raising the fish in the interest of producing more rice. Now he's thinking, since I'm not using a pesticide anymore, could I start putting fish in the rice paddies again? And so he starts to experiment again and discovers that, yes, you know, the he was concerned first that he put the fish in as little fingerlings, the ducklings might eat the fish. But now he discovers another thing, and that is that in the rice paddies there's also a weed that grows, which is called azolla. And it grows, it's a fern-like plant which grows on the surface of the water like a water lily. And so the azolla actually protects the fish. But then he discovers another interesting thing, is that with both ducks and fish in the rice paddies, they both feed on the azolla. They love that as a source of feed, so it keeps the azolla from spreading, so he doesn't need to use an herbicide anymore. And the duck, he doesn't have to feed the ducks and the fish because they got their own feed growing from this rice, from this weed. And then after a period of time, he discovers that the nitrogen levels are actually going up in his water, and he doesn't understand that because he knows there's not enough nitrogen in the droppings of the ducks and the fish to provide the nitrogen. Where is it coming from? So he goes back to the scientists, and the scientists say, well, yeah, you know, actually, you know that azolla plant that has a relationship with bacteria, much like a leguminous plant does on land? And that, so it's producing nitrogen. So that's very likely where your nitrogen's coming from. So now, instead of producing one crop, rice, he's producing five, because he produces duck meat, duck eggs, which he also harvests, fish meat, and rice. And because he's not using a pesticide, he can grow fruit trees on the periphery of his rice paddy, so he's also growing fruit. So he's now producing five crops instead of one without the energy inputs, which was costing him money before, and with less labor. The labor is, you know, planting the rice plants and harvesting the ducks, et cetera. And he's now feeding something like 100 families from 6 acres and doing it in a way that's having a tremendous return to him. So these are some of the kinds of possibilities in these new models of farming. So how do you take, you know, I would love to grow ducks and fish and rice and fruit on my farm in North Dakota, but of course it's not, it's an entirely different ecology. But how could I use those principles and apply them to my farm? And how can I get my land grant university in North Dakota to begin doing the kind of research that can help me understand a prairie ecology that has those kind of capacities in order to do that? And then how would that benefit the contribution that I can make to improve the quality of the water on our farm? Okay, so where are we? We need to get to the end here. First of all, I think it's important to recognize that currently almost all of our research and investment is currently committed to intensifying the current system. There is almost nothing committed to the agroecological approach to solving the problems. So we have to begin helping our public officials understand, help our researchers to understand that as we move into this new future and the loss of the natural resources which have fueled the industrial system, and the sinks in nature which absorb the waste from the industrial system are no longer there, and so we're going to have to move to this other system. There is almost almost no public policies that are devoted to the alternative system. They're almost all devoted to intensifying the current system. And there is almost no research or public policies that are devoted to the agroecological system. Now, a question to raise then is why? Are we just all this stupid that we don't realize this? I don't think that's the case. I think the reason that it's happening is that we have made huge investments in this current system. And, you know, all of us have to really come to appreciate that. I mean, think about this. If you're a farmer and you have invested all of your efforts and your energy for maximum efficient production, for short-term economic return, and you have bought enormous amounts of land, you have invested millions of dollars in equipment, and you've done all of that in order to do exactly what we told them to do. I mean, even our Secretary of Agriculture said, get big or get out, right? Adapt or die. That's what we told them. So they've all done this, and now they're in their 60s. And now we want to go to them and say, gee, now we don't like some of the unintended consequences of what we're doing. We want you to change. It's not going to happen, right? They've made huge investments. The same thing is true of the input companies, companies like Monsanto, et cetera. They've made huge investments in providing the technology to fuel this system. And the processors have made huge investments. I was on the Pew Commission for Industrial Animal Agriculture for 2 years, and we had an opportunity to visit some of these processing plants of these huge processing companies. And the first day that I walked into a Tyson plant in Arkansas, and here's this four-story tall building with millions of chickens circling around through this system and being processed. And I'm looking at this and I'm thinking, you know, they've invested millions and millions of dollars. They're not going to want to listen to us about the kind of changes we want them to consider. You know, so we have to appreciate the huge investments that have been made. We also have to recognize that we are entrenched in a kind of industrial culture. You know, again, if you're interested in reading Rann Eisler, who's written a couple of wonderful books, one is called The Chalice and the Blade and the other, The Real Wealth of Nations. And she points out that there are kind of two cultures in our human communities that we have had, you know, going back, since we've been on the planet. And it's the dominator culture and the partnership culture. And she argues that we actually started out, when we were hunter-gatherers, we started out in a partnership culture because we had to cooperate with each other in order to collect the food from nature like other species and be able to feed ourselves. And then when we started to have settled societies and we had to protect the land that we had for ourselves, we became a dominator culture. And that we've been a dominator culture ever since. And by dominator, it's not only dominating other humans and getting them out of the way, but also dominating nature. So that's how you do things. And we're at a point now, I think, where the dominator culture is increasingly becoming dysfunctional. Because again, we're going to be moving into this new culture where we're going to have to work together and cooperate and more importantly, cooperate with nature and recognize that we are simply, as Aldo Leopold reminded us, not the conquerors of the land community, but simply plain members and citizens. So we have to, and this is difficult because as our scientists tell us, you know, we not only do what we do by our genes, by our genetic heritage, but also by our mean, our cultural heritage. And these are difficult to change. But I think, and I'll mention this in a minute, I think there's a lot of things coming at us which can bring about some significant changes in a short period of time. And then the other thing I think that prevents us from doing these changes is that the current system still works, especially with subsidies. And I don't just mean agriculture subsidies. I mean, we're subsidizing this system at many, many different levels. And again, if you want to read a book that really educated me around how many different kinds of subsidies we actually have to keep this system in place, read David K. Johnson's book, Free Lunch, and it'll give you the whole story and you'll understand why we have that kind of problem. And then finally, of course, one of the other things I think that prevents us from making these kinds of changes is we now have sort of in the public media been given this moral obligation of we have to figure out how we're going to feed 9 billion people. And the implication of that is the only way to do that is to intensify what we've been doing. And we can go into a longer conversation with that. I think that how do we feed 9 billion people is absolutely the wrong question, because we're already producing enough food to feed 9 billion people. We're wasting 30 to 40% of it, depending on whose data you're looking at. Even more importantly than that, the real question we ought to be asking is how do we maintain the health of the land community so that it will continue to be productive into the future, and then how do we eat healthy from that? And there are a number of indicators now of why we need to move in that kind of direction. The other thing is when we raise this question in terms of how are we going to feed the world, the assumption is that we're currently feeding the world from the heartland. And Dick Levin and Mark Mueller with IATP actually published a study back in 1997, which they entitled Feeding the World? And what they did was took a look at how much of the corn and soybeans that are produced in the heartland of the United States that goes down the Mississippi River and gets exported actually goes to the 25 hungriest countries. You know what they found? Here's the numbers. 0.6% of the corn and 0.027% of the soybeans go to the 25 hungriest countries. 70% of the soybeans and 63% of the corn go to the 28 wealthiest countries. So we're not feeding the world. You know, we are producing a lot of food which goes for export, but it goes to the countries who can afford it. The hungry who actually need the food can't afford to buy the things that we export. So we have to keep these things in mind as we think about our future. So here is part of what we have to take into consideration now, because this all looks now, where I'm at now, right? You're thinking, well, what the hell are we going to do about all this? There's no way to solve this. It's just all entrenched and there's nothing we can do. Well, first of all, I want to make clear that, you know, people often ask me, so are you still optimistic? And Vaclav Havel taught me an important lesson. You know, remember when he became president of Czechoslovakia, and Czechoslovakia was such a mess, and somebody asked him if he was optimistic that as president he could do something about that. You remember what he said? He said, no, I'm not optimistic because optimism doesn't help you. He said, if you're an optimist, you figure, well, somebody's going to figure this out, somebody's solving it, and you don't do anything. You go have a beer or something, you know, and you don't do anything. That doesn't help us. And he said, if you're a pessimist, the same thing. You figure, well, it's all going to go to hell anyway. It's nothing I can do. So again, you don't do anything. You go have a beer. He said, what we need is hope. And hope is doing the right thing, even if you don't know how it's going to turn out. And then if you have the right convergence of events, then you can actually accomplish what needs to be accomplished. So hope is what we need. And I am hopeful. And I'm particularly hopeful now because I think we're at this turning point right now where we have to, where we're going to see the potential for enormous changes taking place in the next 10 to 20 years. So here are a couple of things. First of all, the science is now telling us a different kind of story. And there are three reports which came out of the United Nations just in the last couple of years which give us a very different picture of how to, quote, enable the world to feed itself. And all three of those reports, the one being Ag at the Crossroads, the second one, The Right to Food, and the third one, Save and Grow. And they all say essentially the same thing, that technology plays a role, but it's not going to be, it's not this kind of, you know, high technology industrial system taking the Green Revolution, in other words, to Africa. It's not going to feed the world. What we have to do is work with people in their own communities, looking at their own resources, giving them the tools that they need in order to be able to feed themselves and to regenerate the capacity for production of their own land and their own communities. And that's increasingly now becoming, you know, people are becoming aware that that's a direction that we have to move in. The economics is coming up with some new, and I'm going to give you a very short version of this. There are two publications that came out earlier this year in 2011, so this is brand new. And I was not even aware of some of this. It was actually a former student of mine that called to my attention. There is an asset investment manager by the name of Jeremy Grantham. I'd never ever heard of him before. And he writes a newsletter called GMO, which has nothing to do with genetically modified organisms, stands for Grantham, Mayo, and Orley, who are the three people who manage this. But these are people who are providing advice to investors who invest hundreds of billions of dollars a year. So this is a major investment community in our culture. And Jeremy Grantham wrote this newsletter in April. And again, if you want to read it, you can just Google Jeremy Grantham. The title of the newsletter is Time to Wake Up. So just Jeremy Grantham, Time to Wake Up, and it'll come up. Well, here is Jeremy Grantham. Now, again, he's an investment manager who's giving advice to people who want to make money on their money. And the title of his newsletter is Time to Wake Up. The day of unlimited resources and cheap prices is over forever. And so what he's saying, he said, if you've got money and you want to invest, and the way you would have done that in the past, you would have looked for those places in the economy where there's the potential for some cheap natural resources that you can bring in and manufacture and add value to and make a ton of money on. He said, that day is over. Forget it. Because of all of the things that I've just mentioned. So in other words, here is an investment manager who's saying the same thing that a crazy activist farmer like me is saying. And he's saying, this is what we've got to pay attention to now. So if you're going to make money on your money, you've got to move in these new directions. And in the middle of that newsletter, he says that one of the key issues is we have to deal with soil erosion, the problem of soil erosion. Think about this. An investment manager talking about soil erosion as something that we have to deal with. And I read that and I thought, wow, you know, there's hope for the world here. You know, because if you start having major investment counselors giving advice to people who are going to be investing billions of dollars in the future, that's an enormous resource that's suddenly going to be available for us to accomplish the kind of changes that we need to accomplish. The second article was an article that was published in the Harvard Business Review in the January-February issue this year in 2011 by Michael Porter, who is recognized throughout this country and I think throughout the world as one of the leading economists in our academic world, and Mike Kramer, his colleague. And they wrote an article which they entitled Creating Shared Value. And they use this same analysis that Jeremy Grantham does. We are in a very different kind of world now, but they're applying it. Their advice is now written not for people who have money to invest. They're people who are going to be in business. And they're saying the same thing. If you're going to be in business, you can't do business the way you did it in the past. You can't just commodify things and get them as cheaply as possible in order to create value further up the food chain. So you can't marginalize your labor and your raw materials, speak farmers, and in the interest of then simply adding value further up. Because in the future, you're going to have those farmers that are going to provide the kind of value that you're going to need in order to be successful in your business. And in some ways, this is even more important. They're saying, if you're going to be successful in the business tomorrow, you can't just look at the economic success of your company. You also have to look at the social success and at the environmental success, because all of those are going to be bound together in this new world. It's either all going to be healthy or none of it's going to be healthy. So if you're going to be successful in business, this is what you have to do now. And Mark Kramer is now out there doing workshops with major companies trying to help them realize why they have to redesign their business if they're going to be successful in the decades ahead. You got to create shared value. Okay. And then there are also changing, so we got changes at the science level, we got changes at the economic level, and we got changes at the social level. And here's some interesting things. So an interesting question as we think about all this, how does change happen anyway? And here is a business design specialist by the name of Richard Ugo, who published a book a few years ago called Smart World. And he asked this question, how does change happen? And he said that most of us think that the way that change happens is you have this kind of lone ranger that comes in, you know, with a new idea, a forceful way of approaching things, and they bring about the change. He said, if you look at it historically, that's never how change happens. The way change happens, you have the evolution of a new, what he calls a new idea space, and then change takes place within that new culture. And he has a number of interesting examples, some of which are not my favorite ones, like, you know, how Barbie dolls became popular. But One example that he uses that I think is a great example is how cubism and art developed. And he said, we always attribute that to Picasso. He was the Lone Ranger, you know, that brought this revolution to art. But he said, when you look at it historically, that's not how it happened. He said, what was happening at that time is people in the field of art, many people in art were already becoming dissatisfied with some of the traditional forms. Some were already experimenting with new kinds of possibilities. It created this new idea space. And then Picasso came into that new idea space and put cubism on canvas, and it revolutionized the world of art forever. And when I read that, I thought, this is exactly what's happening in the food system today. You know, we have got new idea spaces around food, and everybody, I don't need to go into detail here. You know, you could not have imagined a Michael Pollan writing a book about food 10 years ago and have it being on the New York Times bestseller list for years. It would not have happened. We got this new idea space. We've got new young people in agriculture producing food in a new way. We've got all these things going on. So it is an enormous opportunity now for us to anticipate significant changes taking place. The other thing that I think is important, and I learned this lesson from Paul Roberts. You know, Paul Roberts wrote this book, The End of Oil, and he had a wonderful prologue to his book in which he gave a short description of what the future will look like as a result of the increase of cost in fossil fuels. And then he has a short paragraph in the middle of that prologue, and he says, so it's not a question of whether or not change will come. Change will come. The question is whether it'll come in an orderly, peaceful way or a violent and chaotic way because we waited too long to begin planning for it. And I read that and I thought, you know, I always thought that my mission in life was to change the world. You know, it hasn't worked out that well, but that's what I thought the mission was. And then I read this and I thought, I don't have to change the world. The changes are coming. What I should devote myself to is planning for the changes that are going to come. And it really changed the way I devote my energies and what I try to think about doing. And I think it's an important thing for all of us to think about. I don't think that we're ready now for the changes that are going to come in the next 20 years. We're not anywhere near ready. And we should think about what is going to happen. You know, and I the young family that's operating our farm now, you know, I've been having a conversation with them. I said, I want you to imagine that 10 years from now, crude oil will be $300 a barrel, that we have twice as many severe weather events. What do we want to put on the landscape in order for the farm to be productive under those circumstances? That's what I want to imagine and think about as we think about the future. Okay, I want to get to the questions here. So how's all this going to play out? Well, you know, Yogi Berra made an interesting comment once. He said that prediction is difficult, especially about the future. And I think that's a wise, you know, Yogi Berra had this capacity for some really wise little statements like that, and that's a wise statement. I don't think that we should try to predict how all of this is going to play out. Again, the important thing is to recognize that this is a critical moment in our history, in the history of the human species, that we have enormous potential for change now, and that we have to each decide within our own communities what role we're going to play in trying to bring about the future that we need. And I think in all of this, and I'm going to close with this, I think there's some lessons from nature that would be useful to keep in mind as we decide what role that we're each going to play. One of those lessons comes from C.S. Holling, and you know, he incidentally is an enormous resource because most of his writing was about the science of ecology. Not a lot of it applied to agriculture, but much of what he wrote and produced immediately could be applied to agriculture as an enormous resource. And he said at one point that there are two kinds of resilience. It's what he called ecological resilience and engineering resilience. Engineering resilience is, again, the dominator culture. We go in and we figure out, you know, how to change things in order to try to make them resilient. Ecological resilience is looking at nature. How does nature reproduce itself? How does nature maintain its capacity for renewal, for self-renewal, and then learn from that and how we adapt? That's ecological resilience. I think that's the wiser path to take. Aldo Leopold provided us with some incredible wisdom from the past. You know, he said at one point that based on 20 years of observation in nature, that one of the lessons he had learned is that nature abhors the density of any species. That whenever you have a density of any species, which then begins to disrupt the self-renewing capacity of the synergy of the whole, and then he says nature will always find a way to reduce that density of species, and if one approach fails, she will find another. And so the important thing about the lesson in that is that, you know, this kind of specialization that we have, and so we have, you know, a corn species out there and a soybean species and a wheat species, when what we ought to be thinking about is what is the kind of diversity of species that enhances the capacity for self-renewal of the whole landscape. And that then takes us to a second insight from Walter Leopold, and that is his insistence that what we really needed to work on is the whole issue of land health. And what he meant by land health was the land's capacity to renew itself, and that our major task as a human species was to enhance that capacity, you know, in our own ecologies and in our own neighborhoods. So all of that, I would argue, is how we deal with the issue of water. So I hope that the take-home message that you get from here is that we need to now, as we think about our future, to shift from simply focusing on water and how do we protect that, and looking at how we maintain and enhance the health of the whole, of which water will be a part. And then I think we're going to see the real changes in the Gulf of Mexico and in our own drinking water and in the capacity of the amount of water that we need in order to sustain our system. So let me quit there and we'll go to the panel.
Well, amazing insights from this crazy activist farmer, to which I would add philosopher, analyst, and prophet. Thank you so very much, Fred. So I'd like to quickly introduce our panel of speakers. And Fred, you're certainly welcome.
I can sit down, okay.
Take a seat if you wish or remain standing. So let me just introduce our panelists quickly, and I'd like them to just offer a brief reflection for a minute or two of the insights and the framing that they have with respect to this very compelling story we've just heard. So first, George Booty. George is the executive director of the Land Stewardship Project, an organization here with 2,800 members, helps family farmers raise crops and livestock with sustainable and ecologically sound methods. Has worked on a number of federal and state policy initiatives and directed projects including the Monitoring Project, measuring impacts of farms transitioning from row crops to rotational grazing, the Chippewa 10% Project models and analyzes water quality improvements and other benefits due to diversification of land use. He earned his master's degree in horticulture and human nutrition right here at the University of Minnesota. After George, and coming my way, is Mary Jo Forbord. With her husband, Laverne, they own and operate Prairie Horizons Farm near Starbuck, Minnesota. Since 2001, 90% of their 480-acre farm was converted from conventional dairy operation to tall grass prairie. Their low-lying Black Angus cattle graze with no grain, antibiotics, drugs, hormones, and less than 5 gallons of fuel spent for each animal birthing to market. They are leaders in working lands initiatives, supporting conservation practices on working farms. She's a registered dietitian at the university and trained at the U of M, and at the U of M Morris is the coordinator of the Morris Healthy Eating Initiative. She's former executive director of the Sustainable Farming Association of Minnesota, a past president of the Minnesota Dietetic Association, and past chair of the Hunger and Environmental Nutrition Practice Group of the American Dietetic Association. And finally, and closest to me, Professor David Mulla. David earned his master's and doctoral degrees in agronomy from Purdue University with an emphasis in soil chemistry and soil physics. He's professor and the W. E. Larson Chair for Soil and Water Resources in our Department of Soil, Water, and Climate here at the University of Minnesota, and in 2004 was appointed director of the Precision Agriculture Center here at the university. In 2007, he became one of the founding fellows at the University of Minnesota's Institute on the Environment. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences Committee on Water Quality and member of the Minnesota West Central Regional Sustainable Development Partnership Board. He's a fellow in the Soil Science Society of America and a fellow in the Agronomy Society of America. He studies non-point source pollution of surface and groundwater, precision farming and precision conservation, alternative farm management strategies for improved soil quality and sustainability, and alternative policies for soil and water resource management. So with that, I'd like to ask George to perhaps start, and then we'll come this way.
Thank you, Dean Eldy, and thanks, Dr. Kirschenmann, for those insightful remarks, and many of them, too. just a couple things about hope. I want to start with hope, where you kind of left off, and then touch on a point or two on resilience. I find hope in a couple of things. There are a number of, we have a Farm Beginnings graduate or Farm Beginnings training program in the Land Stewardship Project, and there are a number of young graduates who are very energetic and enthusiastic, and there are similar programs around the country, so I derive a lot of hope from that. And their approach is often taking an agroecological approach. There are two programs I want to point out in the federal policy program that I think are building blocks toward a different future, and one of those is the Conservation Stewardship Program, which pays ideally people for conservation outcomes, farmers for conservation outcomes, and the other is the Beginning Farmer Rancher Development Program, which provides funds for training beginning farmers. So I take hope from that and acknowledge your point that the structure of the whole program is very problematic. On the resilience point of view, I think we're engaged in the Chippewa 10% Project, as you mentioned, which is an attempt to work with row crop farmers to help put the puzzle pieces together to help change certain fields out of row crops and into perennials, ideally. And that means working with farmers like Mary Jo and potentially beginning farmers to make that happen, because row crop farmers themselves may not choose to run animals on a field or two. So it's a set of puzzle pieces to put together. I do think at the same time we need to find how to have conversations about the difficult issues that you articulated. And I think when we talk about the problems with the system, that's often received as blame. I'm in the system, I'm using it because I'm doing what I have been asked, as you point out, but that's received as blame. So we have to overcome that. But we have to have those conversations. We also have to have the conversation about power and concentration of wealth by the amongst some of the corporations that you mentioned and others, because it's an issue. So we have to find ways of doing that and the policies to address that. And then just finally on resilience, I think soil health and soil quality is the heart of that resilience, I think, as you mentioned. And that derives in part from diversity of soil organisms in the soil and the diversity of crops on top of the soil. And it, part of what enables that diversity is livestock on the land. So we have something we need to deal with, which is how do we get more livestock back on the land? One piece of hope about that is that with high corn prices, cow-calf operations are being asked to raise cows for a longer period of time on grass than they were a few years ago because of the cost of corn. So anyway, a piece of hope.
Great. Thank you. Mary Jo?
Thank you. I'm going to start with the resilience, because it seems like Fred is certainly exploring where the cracks are in the system and in all of the systems. I really wish we had more people looking at the cracks in the system. We seem to be a lot better at identifying what is unsustainable, because at that point all the resiliency is gone. It is the end of resiliency, and really it's too late to do anything. I think Fred pointed out a lot of the reasons why doing more of the same, only faster and bigger, can only lead to an endpoint that we don't want to see. I think the most famous statistic I hear is the 9 billion by 2050. And I don't know why we're so fixated on that statistic. I have all kinds of questions around that statistic of being an endpoint, because, you know, I do think about 2051. And you know, those 9 billion people are not done reproducing. I wonder what they're eating, what we are feeding them, what their BMIs are, for those of you in the nutrition world, the measurement of obesity. We in the United States have a few problems to figure out for ourselves before we export our way of doing things across the world. I do think a measure of humbleness and learning from nature is in order. I see some really hopeful signs of that, in particular with the conservation community and their movements toward working with private landowners. We have a prairie very near our home, and we are actually blessed with a number of hilltop prairies that give us an example to follow of the diversity that grows in the plant communities there. But the prairie was bought and put on sort of a museum shelf for 30 years while the Fish and Wildlife Service sort of figured out that, you know, these are dynamic natural systems, and you can't just preserve it. It needs to be used in a judicious way. Balance is one of the things that we seem to, you know, be very, very difficult for us to absorb and really put into practice. We do have wisdom of the past that we need to pay attention to. There was a culture before us that lived from the prairie for thousands of years. There's a lot of wisdom from the past. I think in the current day, we are in a way revaluing what we value, which is a very good thing. For a long time, we've been perhaps overvaluing knowing a lot about something and probably not valuing enough knowing something about a lot of things. We need the people who get the connections. I will just end on also a note of hope, and it goes to the young people. Probably I have to make a little correction on the bio, or my husband, who's home farming, would say, you know, add that decimal point to the gallons of fuel that it takes us to birth a animal in the pasture. It's 0.5 gallons. It's a half a gallon of fuel. So we're trying to reduce that carbon footprint, the fossil fuel use. But, you know, our chief export in farm country have been our young people. We've lost a lot of natural resources, and we don't seem to be able to get them out as fast and as cheap and as much as someone else needs them. I think rather than feed the world, sometimes we're feeding agribusiness in rural America. But I don't see babies anymore. And, you know, I thought gray hair was what everybody had. I'm glad to see a lot of you don't have gray hair. I get to work on the campus of the University of Minnesota Morris, and probably one of the greatest things that has happened lately is a new student organization. They're called the Foodlums. The purpose of the Foodlums shall be to work for more local, humane, fair, and ecologically sound food on campus, to have discussions about food and food production and food policy, to host events, and to raise awareness about food issues. And my proud addendum to my bio is that I'm their advisor. They are the ones that are going to retool and reimagine and revalue and put things in order. We need their design. We need their innovativeness. We need their idealism. We need our young people in rural America. And they are the ones that give me hope.
Fantastic. David?
Thank you. I would like to say that I was very moved by your speech, and I learned a lot, and thank you very much. I would like to give a little bit of Minnesota context for some of the trends that he mentioned in his speech. I think Minnesotans care deeply about their environment, their lakes, their rivers, their groundwater, their land. And I'm talking about the citizens as well as the farmers. There is a strong stewardship ethic, and this is kind of evidenced by the fact that the voters of the state passed the Clean Water Legacy Act, which was a tax increase of 0.375, and that raised about $80 million a year for investment in clean water, and another $80 million a year for acquisition of critical habitat and restoration of lands So this is very hopeful, and I think the state is now really gearing up to implement these programs in a very large way. So there, we've just finished a big project for the state legislature to rank all the lands of the state of Minnesota for ecological value. And the idea behind that project is to be able to target this $160 million of new money to the most ecologically sensitive lands so we can get perennial crops and other types of good practices on the land in the places where it will make the biggest difference. I'm very hopeful that that program will make a difference. I'd also like to say that at the federal government level, the USDA has started a national initiative for food and agriculture, which is changing the way that funding for research is handled. And the federal government is now putting a lot of money into research on perennial crops. And a lot of the best research in the country is actually happening in Iowa, Wisconsin, and Minnesota. We have the world's leading experts in the world doing research at Cedar Creek on biodiversity of grasses and diversity of legume-grass mixtures. We have some of the leading experts in the world doing work on perennial wheat and alfalfa, which could be used in strategic locations on the landscape. Minnesota was the world leader and still is the world leader in precision agriculture, which is the 10th largest revolution in agriculture that's ever occurred through the history of human beings. And so there are a lot of positive things that are happening in the state of Minnesota. The yield of corn over the last 30 years, maybe you don't know this, it has actually doubled because of the huge investments of research in that particular crop. At the same time, the use of fertilizer has stayed level, so we have not increased the amount of fertilizer applied to crops. What we need now is similar types of investment in perennial crops, because the biomass of perennial crops is woefully inadequate relative to these systems which have been invested in heavily. For instance, switchgrass in Minnesota yields about 4 tons an acre. Corn has a biomass of about 20 tons. So if you just look at the economics of growing various biomass products on the landscape, especially when commodity prices are high like they are now, there's no incentive whatsoever to grow perennial crops. There's no market. And that has to change in order for widespread changes to happen. There are other policy changes that are really needed, and I think some of these were outlined. There was a law passed that set the price of milk according, the price of milk increased according to the distance from Wisconsin. As a result of that, a lot of the dairy production in Wisconsin and Minnesota moved to California because you could get higher subsidies for growing, for raising milk and dairy cows in California, which is the farthest you can get from Wisconsin. And as a result, we lost large numbers of animals and grazing operations in our most sensitive and fragile lands in southeastern Minnesota. And those lands have now been replaced with soybeans, which is a very environmentally fragile crop. So we have a number of serious issues that need to be addressed. And I just wanted to mention that a lot of those issues are being studied very seriously, and there are a lot of serious people in the state who are trying to make changes on the landscape. For example, Minnesota is a leader in conservation reserve program. We have 1.7 million acres of land that is retired and planted to grass, or where wetlands are restored. We had another program which is called the Conservation Reserve Enhancement Program, which led to 100,000 acres of wetlands and grasses being implemented in the Minnesota River Basin. So Minnesota has been a leader for a long time in some of these conservation programs, and I hope we can continue to do so. Thank you.
Thank you all. So it's now time for your comments and questions. And again, to remind you, we have two means. One is note cards, and some of you have filled out some questions on note cards. And then secondly, we have some roving microphones. I see one right here. And I see another. Actually, I see two up here. So let me deploy these. So, but let's go first with a question from a card here. Currently, we subsidize corn and beans to send to Colorado to feed beef. We leave the manure at the feedlot as pollution. What would happen if we subsidized grass-fed beef directly and stopped growing corn and beans? Who wants to take that one from the panel? Mary Jo?
You know, I'm not so sure we need a subsidy on grass-fed animal products. When we have cut our fuel use to a half a gallon from the average of 35 gallons, we're doing okay. And when we, you know, you consider corn-fed beef needing 30 pounds of corn to produce 1 pound of beef, we can produce an infinite amount of beef with 0 pounds yeah. of corn.
Yeah. Excellent. Touché.
Can I just say, if there is a subsidy, it might be to pay for some of those ancillary public benefits that come from those kinds of production systems, like a conservation stewardship program. But because once you start subsidizing a particular crop or product, it can distort the market for it, too.
Here's a question maybe Fred would tackle, and our roving microphones, feel free to find someone who's ready with a question for the next one. So, Fred, how is that, quote, new idea space recognized? Does an organic farmer share the same new idea space with Monsanto or a land-grant researcher?
Well, the point that Richard Ugel makes about that is not saying a particular idea, but rather that you have this new culture that emerges with different people, actually different people within that space exploring different kinds of possibilities. That's what creates the idea space. So it's not a matter of saying, you don't have an idea space unless you got a lot of organic farmers. You know, you got a new idea space when you got all different kinds of people, you know, looking at different possibilities in our food system. And that's one of the reasons that we have the kind of, both some animosity and rich conversation going on is because we have, you know, all of these different things. You got some people who are absolutely convinced that if we just all go organic, we'll solve all the world's problems. Others convinced that if we just all start become vegans, we'll solve all the world's problems. You know, that's all a part of the new idea space. The thing is, it's not just all staying the same anymore, and it's with that richness of that idea space that you have the potential for significant changes to take place.
Interesting. I like the way you characterized wisdom from the past and the best current science.
Yeah.
I mean, that seems to be a characteristic that would for a genuine new idea space.
Yeah.
Has the Leopold Center been instrumental in can't quite read the passing conservation law initiatives that may have shaped some cultural change in Iowa's agriculture?
Well, somebody's being very generous, but I think the Leopold Center has made some significant contributions. But, we had, when I first became director of the Leopold Center in 2000, and I went back and read the minutes of the previous, we have an advisory board, the minutes of the previous board, you know, going back about 2 years. And then I ran across the board minutes of a meeting that had been held in the previous April meeting. And one of the board members asked a really interesting question, He said, so we've been in business for 12 years now, so what's changed? And if you read the legislation that created the Leopold Center, we're clearly supposed to bring about change. And so I asked my staff, so how did you answer that question? I said, well, you know, I don't think anybody really answered it. And we're still wrestling with the whole issue of how change actually happens and how it takes place. And I think what the Leopold Center has done is to, again, put some new ideas into the mix, and I think that's created some interesting conversations. I think that, again, the kind of changes that we need are not going to come because we're going to bring about the changes. They're going to come because the current system is increasingly not going to function. And so again, that's why I think Paul Roberts' insight was so important. It's not a question of whether or not the change will come. It's a question of whether or not we know it's going to come in a violent and chaotic way because we waited too long to begin planning for it. So it's planning for the changes that are going to come. And I'm at least doing what I can to influence all of us connected with the Leopold Center to now put more of our energies into planning for the changes that are coming. So we want to look at the models that are working, and we've started to do some of that. And there's some, there's some farmers that are doing some amazing things. You have farmers like Francis Tickey, for example. His is a very low energy input farm. You know, when crude oil gets to $300 a barrel, it's not going to affect him that much. Those are the kinds of models we need to look at.
Okay, I think we have a question from the microphone in the back here.
Yeah, I have a question about the upcoming farm bill that's going to define agricultural policy at the federal level for the next many years. Can you identify one or two key points in that farm bill that we should focus on? And particularly if there's anything that a small number of people or organizations in Minnesota can do to influence that.
You started talking about
George.
Did I? No. I don't know how we're going to influence it. It may be already done, but I mentioned a couple of programs that I think are key. On the conservation side, I think we need to ask our representatives, Colin Peterson, who's the ranking minority member on that, to support conservation, to support rural development, to support the kind of research programs that Dave mentioned in his comments. I think the action, if you will, is moving toward risk management insurance. I think it's fair to say, should there be caps on how much any one farmer can receive from that, and what are the conditions under which that's received? Should there be conservation measures enacted in order to receive the insurance? So I think those are the kinds of questions I think could be raised right at the moment, but there's not much time. I mean, it may be a done deal already. We're not sure.
Yeah. Other comments, Mary Jo?
I'm still trying to get over what Colin Peterson told me around the last farm bill, which was in a room full of 30 people, he said, they hate people like you in Washington. Do you know who really writes the farm bill? It's all the agribusiness lobbyists. And, at the end, they put on a few plums to placate you. So with that in mind, a plum that I would pick that would placate me would be if we could grow fruits and vegetables on program acres without being penalized and losing any kind of benefit from the farm program at all. That would give us a more diverse food supply, a healthier food supply close to home, which is the equivalent of food security.
Yeah, interesting. Good point. I think this is directed at Fred. You didn't tell us what the USDA said about the proposal from Wes about 50 years of perennial grass research. Don't make us guess.
Well, it was really interesting. Kathleen Merrigan brought together a group of the scientists from the Agriculture Research Service, and Wes Jackson, of course, was the primary target of their concerns and their questions. And I thought the meeting went really, really well. I mean, they asked really good questions. Wes answered them really well, and we had a great conversation. And then at the end of our meeting, person who was facilitating the conversation turned to Wes and said, "This has been really helpful." And he said, "I want to talk to some more of my colleagues, and then I'm going to write up a proposal, which I'm going to send to you as to how we might move this forward." And I thought, wow, you know, I've never been in a meeting with bureaucrats. You know, usually they say, well, we'll get back to you, and then, of course, they never do. And this was such a positive response, and I thought, this something's really going to happen here. And so I think it was about 2 months later, I had a chance to talk to Wes on the phone, and I said, have you gotten the proposal yet? And he said, no, I haven't heard. I said, you haven't heard anything? And he said, no, I haven't heard anything. And so I happened to know Kathleen Merrigan's chief of staff, or at least who was chief of staff back then. So I called him up, and I said, you know, so what's happened here? And he said, I don't know, but let me find out. And then he never got back to me. And so, you know, it just seemed like the whole thing just died. But then here about 6 or 8 months ago, Kathleen Merrigan published a blog on her website, which started out, and one of the things Wes did when we went out there, he took his, you know, some of you have seen this, but, you know, he has now a photograph of a perennial root system, which is like 18 feet long and about 2 feet in diameter. And then alongside that is a photograph of an annual root system, which is about, you know, 3 inches in diameter, about 15 inches long. And so it's this contrast. So Kathleen Merrigan hung this photograph. When you first come inside USDA and there's that open space with the balconies and there are the photographs of all of the past secretaries of agriculture, et cetera. And she had hung this photograph from the balcony and was standing it, looking up at it. And then she wrote this blog in which she said that USDA was now going to commit 3 scientists to work on this project, you know, with in cooperation with the Land Institute. And so I thought, okay, you know, that's not what Wes asked for, but you know, it's a move in that direction. And I understand, you know, I'm not a political wonk, but I do understand how politics work. And so, you know, it's a step in that direction. The other thing that's really encouraging now, I think, in terms of, you know, the contribution that Wes is making, what the Land Institute is doing, is there are now a couple of major foundations that have expressed really strong interest. And, you know, Wes now is thinking of a $2 billion grant over, you know, the next 40 or 50 years to accomplish this. And I think with that, we can accomplish what the goal of the 50-year Farm Bill was. And USDA is going to be in there with 3 scientists. That'll be great. It'll be help. So I, you know, I'm hopeful that that we may actually make this happen. So it's
okay. This I think could be addressed. Oh, we got one live question over here.
So this kind of follows up a little bit on the last couple of responses that have been given, but. So looking at the idea that we need to redesign, we need to redesign the system, what hope is there currently that people in the position, policymakers, funders, are actually understanding that, or is it still more the mindset that we just need to figure out how to do this better and produce more? And
yeah, it's a really important question, and here's an example for you. Just last week, there was an article in the New York Times, which was about the fact that Pilgrim's Pride, which, as you all know, is one of the largest poultry processing facilities in the country, they now, as of the 15th of October, had already lost $400 million this year. Now, they obviously can't continue to do that very long into the future. And according to the article, the appeal which they were making to solve this problem was to get the farmers and the retailers to pick up more of the cost of feed, because it was the cost of feed which was creating this huge loss for them. So when I read that, I thought, you know, gee, we're already there. Where this system, which was so efficient, you know, it's the maximum efficient production for short-term economic return, you know, for Pilgrim's Pride, is already not working. You can't lose $400 million at the, you know, three quarters of the year through the year and continue into business very long in the future. So I think that that's why the analysis by Jeremy Grantham and Michael Porter are so important, because they're recognizing from the point of view of investment and from the point of view of business models that the era of unlimited cheap raw materials and cheap prices is over forever, and we have to redesign. If we're going to be successful in business, we have to redesign the business now. And so, So I don't think it's going to be a matter of, you know, any one of us or any group of us, you know, bringing about, you know, political pressure or whatever to do the redesign. The redesign is going to come because as the raw materials, which the cheap raw materials, which previously kept the system going, are not going to be there, and the ability, therefore, to marginalize the raw material supplies in order to add value elsewhere aren't going to work as a business model anymore. So people who are going to want to be successful in business, simply from an economic perspective, are going to have to think about how to redesign the system. And so I think that's why I'm hopeful about the fact that these changes now, when the business world recognizes that the old system is longer working, can perhaps happen pretty quickly.
I have a question I'd like to ask Professor Mulla. What is the role of hydroponic controlled environment agriculture in the future as a part of the solution, that is, for the efficient use of water?
Well, I don't think it's very good. I think hydroponics is a pretty intensive process for producing food. I think, you know, the most efficient way to produce food is by using the land and the soil and the water that we get and the sunlight. That's the way our cropping systems evolved, and hydroponics might be good for some specialized, you know, type of crops, maybe vegetables in particular. So it has some value, particularly if we want to grow some food in the winter time. But there are other ways of doing that in Minnesota which don't require, you know, hydroponics. You can use hoop houses, and there's a lot of local know-how on how to produce food even through the winter time for local food consumption. I think one of the big, really big issues for Minnesotans, you're thinking about what you can do, is to try and insist that, you know, our local institutions like hospitals and schools rely more on locally grown food. If we could get a law passed, for instance, in the state of Minnesota that mandated a certain amount of locally grown food, especially vegetables and fruits, had to be served in our hospitals and our schools, that would go a long way towards changing our food production system towards something that's more sustainable and more healthy. So I think there are some solutions maybe that are a little more feasible and that could have some real big implications for how we produce food and where it comes from and how healthy it is. And it would also help some of our, you know, the populations that really have the worst diets. If you can start training kids from a young age to eat healthy, that's a lifetime habit that lasts.
Great. Question from the floor.
I've been asked to stand.
As I'm standing, I'll make a comment that my son goes to a school where they've gotten a grant from the Lifetime Fitness Foundation to serve locally grown food in their school cafeteria, which I think is a really cool program. So that's a sign of hope. But that's not what my question is about. I'm becoming increasingly frustrated by the folks that are that keep saying that we have to feed 9 billion people and or however many billion people are on the planet right now and in the future, and that somehow that's the Midwest's obligation and that makes it okay to pollute our land and water. And especially in light of the fact that so much of the corn that's grown isn't actually food, it's used for fuel and making other products, and the what you talked about in terms of the food waste and obesity. And I'm looking for a more productive way to engage in that conversation and sort of respond to those folks who are introducing that, you know, we have to feed all of these people and so we have to just do it, and it's going to cause these pollution problems, and we're going to have to live with it, essentially.
Who wants? Dave,
I would like to start out by trying to answer that, and I would like to give an example of something I'm doing. I'm working in Morocco, which is a country that doesn't have a very high standard of living. And the climate in Morocco is actually getting a lot drier. So the traditional cropping systems, which are used in the steeper mountainous areas, which are annual cropping systems that rotate wheat and legumes, are not very sustainable anymore. We're going in and we're trying to give farmers a third crop, an alternative, which is perennial fruit trees like olives and figs and almonds. And we're planting, so far in the last 3 years, we've planted 40 million almond, fig, and olive trees on 40,000 hectares of land. This each of the people who farms the land owns about 1 hectare of land. So we're positively changing the lives of 40,000 individuals. We're halfway through the project. We intend to have 80 million trees planted on about 80,000 hectares, and we'll be hopefully affecting 80,000 people who will roughly double their annual income and become self-sufficient in their food and their food needs. So, I mean, this is really the way to address that issue. It's to go and find the systems that work in each area of the world, see what is naturally adapted to those areas and what takes a minimum amount of resources to grow. You don't want to go into, you know, Morocco and say, well, why don't you grow bananas or, you know, oil palm trees or something like that.
Corn and soybeans.
You know, you have to kind of match the climate, the soils, and the use naturally available materials. So that's just an example of how I think this should play out in different parts of the world.
Could I just touch on that for a moment?
Please, please.
Fred, you mentioned the colleague you know in Japan. And, I mean, there are good examples of that in several parts of the world where people are really doing that. And in the UN reports that you mentioned suggest that really good, that the economic development that comes in poor countries comes through particularly women in agriculture, and they need to raise food crops, also for sale, but so I think that's an important piece to address, and there are good resources on that. And then just back here at home, I think we're finding here at home that we need to grow more of our food in proximity when we can. We can't always do that. And so that includes in urban areas, so there's a lot more people growing food in urban areas and farming in some cases. That's kind of new. It's part of that idea space. So I think there's lots of different ways to address it.
I got to share an interesting irony with you around all of this. It was an article in the New York Times last week called "Rooting the Uprooted," and it was a story. It's a story about all of the examples were women, so I think they are all women. These are women, and there was a big photograph at the head of the article, and they were all black women. Women from places like Somalia, who have come to this country and have settled in resource-poor communities because they don't have a lot of money, discovering that people in those resource-poor communities in our country didn't have enough food to eat, so they started finding places to grow food, vegetables that are starting in farmers' market, and they're now feeding our people. So, you know, there. I mean, again, I think the point that you were making about what's appropriate to each locality and how we can, you know, use the human energy and the natural resources that are available. And, you know, we can, I'm absolutely convinced that feeding people is not the problem. You know, we can do that. The real question that we have to raise is what's the carrying capacity of the planet in terms of, because it's not just producing enough food. It's, you know, the whole health of the ecology and that density of species that Ola Leopold talked about that I think we have to entertain.
On that note, the wisdom of Aldo Leopold, I think we should probably adjourn the formal presentation here tonight. I have a whole stack of great, great questions that we couldn't get to because of time. But on behalf of the Freshwater Society and the University of Minnesota, I'm really grateful for all of you who have come here tonight, and especially grateful for our panelists and our distinguished speaker for presenting information on the complex and intersecting issues that make this not simple, but complex, and yet raising strategies that make us hopeful for a way forward. And I think that's really an important message. And I'm so pleased with seeing so many of you young people who I presume are students. Great to have you all here, and you're our hope as we go forward in this. So thank you for being here and for the questions that you've submitted as well. So on behalf of all of us, thanks very much to our distinguished panelists and guests.